Anyway, today I'm starting a little bit of a new series for these real bored lectures. I mean, I like Legend 88. I'd love to go over every last one of his games and so many others, but, I had an idea. As many of you know, a certain player happened to do very, very well in his best of 10 series this year against Guli. So I thought, why don't we go back and look at some of the earliest games from some of the top players in the Go world, such as Sedol. Go over one of his earliest games. Yu Cheng Ho, I want to go over one of his earliest games. Let's see, Kong Ji, definitely want to go over one of his. Who else? Not sure who else. But there's a bunch of players. I want to go over some of their earliest games to see how they played, to see how everything changed. So yeah, that's my idea currently for this particular series. And I thought we would start with Sedol for obvious reasons. So in this game, we are going back. We are going back all the way to 1997. 1997, when Sedol, who is black in this game, was a one dan professional. That's going far back. 1997, one dan pro. And yet nowadays he's like top of the world. So the question is, that was on my mind when I began this, like what was his style like? Do we see like evidence that he's like really being aggressive? Did he play a completely different style? How did this thing that is Sedol evolve? So he's up against someone we don't see a lot nowadays. He's up against Cheng Hao. Let's see, what was he at the time? I think it was an 8-dan professional, Cheng Hao was. And he is white. Now, right away, black decides to approach a 4-4 point rather than take either open corner. So, all right, we're seeing hints that maybe he's an aggressive player. But we don't have verification of that just yet. Maybe he's playing this because he wants to build a large framework and make a huge Moyo influential game. Only way to find out is to continue plodding along. All right. Ching Hao backs off. All right, we're getting into some pretty normal stuff. Yusidol takes a 3-4 point that is facing here, so he was using this lovely little guy as a probe as sorts, seeing what he can do. Might be able to go into a mini Chinese. Definitely not going to see a micro Chinese at this point because it hadn't been invented yet. That definitely bears noting. Like, we are way back in time on this one. All right, white takes another corner. And now we've got the ability. We can expect to see mini Chinese, we can expect to see an enclosure. Instead, we see a high approach. So rather than develop a framework, rather than grab territory, he's being aggressive. So I think it stands to reason right now that Isidol has always been aggressive since the moment he began playing Go. Evidence suggests that he's always been aggressive. Let's see where that aggression takes him. Now, as white, big decisions for Cheng Hao. Big, big, big decisions. He could pincer. But fundamentally, that kind of, even though that's completely okay, it feels a little strange as white here. Because we have to remember that our opponent approached us. We responded, he buggered off. We took a corner, and he still hasn't done anything down here. So we kind of want to try to put pressure on this part of the board, because our opponent is just like blissfully ignoring it. So okay, white approaches, we now have a complicated game on our hands. All right. Now it's black's decision to decide how aggressive he wants to be. In light of this rather unusual stone, we don't usually see two space high approaches anymore, do we? When was the last time I've seen that? In an amateur game, I would think. I don't remember the last time I've seen it professionally. But there are a lot of options here. Could pincer and try to aid while applying pressure. If that happens, you are saying my corner is forfeit. You could attach, make shape here, depending, you know, how your opponent wants to play. I can't, predict how he might want to do that. There's a bunch of different ways that you can get shape here while your opponent defends himself. Let's see, what else do we have here? A lot of variations there. Your opponent could say, you know what, I don't want to do that. I'm going to play a nice solid move. Chances are you're going to back off somewhere, but no matter where you back off to, there's going to be open invasion points, your undercut. I can still take territory if I so feel like. So a lot of options here. Black instead says, take as much influence as you want. I don't care. So the question to you, dear viewers, is why might Sedol be inclined to play a move such as this and say, take as much territory as you want? Isn't that more Li Cheng Ho style, like give your opponent exactly what he wants and then still somehow win? Why is Sedol doing it? That's a little unusual. What do you think? What is the reason for that? Well, as it turns out, it's really, really easy to see. If our opponent responds and goes for all of the influence that he so wants, we have to remember that we already have stones on this part of the board. So all we need is sente, right? Extend, and then what is this turning into? This is going to turn into what? Nothing? We're just going to live here and wonder what these stones are ever going to do ever again? That doesn't seem like it's a very good strategy for white to employ. And I love going over games on a real board because I can do variations like that without screwing up a tree. All right. So white says, I got my response. I see that's an issue. Let's go and put pressure here. All right. Fair enough. Black goes into the corner like we would expect even to this day. White plays the Hane as we would expect so far. With the exception of one little unusual move, this game isn't looking at all old. It could have been played just yesterday, for all we knew. Right? Black comes back. White takes two space extension. And black plays a diagonal. This game just showed its age. Because we do not see this anymore at all. Not at all. Nowadays, we would see things like throw in, we would see things like attachment. This very, very unusual. This is a variation no one's happy with. Because rather than defend, White backs off here, nice and modern. Now when we throw in, we reach a variation that everyone's pissed at, because it looks like this is aggressive play. It looks aggressive, and it is aggressive. It's trying to destroy all of White's shape, right? Yeah, honey, there we go. There's only one slight problem with that. While we are busy happily destroying White's shape, White is busy happily destroying our shape. And now we are left with this. Oh yeah, ain't that pretty. What is that? Are we calling that thickness? We're not calling that thickness, right? That'd be crazy. No. That's not thickness. Does it have shape? Not, no? It's kind of hard to kill. I mean, it's got like potential to make a bunch of eyes, so it's pretty resilient and it can jump out and do things, so I guess it's not gonna die. Can't really kill anyone because our opponent can take that move and live instantly, and oh my dear god, we don't want to play that because that's just making matters so much worse. So we can't really attack White right now, and White really can't attack us, and no one really has potential to do anything else from this point. I mean, it's just kind of a position that's resolving itself into a way no one's happy with, which is why we don't see this variation anymore. Because Black doesn't like it, White doesn't like it, no one's a fan of this variation. But, alright, I mean, we don't need extra moves there right now, so Black plays away. Completely understandable. And then goes under. Now that seems like it might be a little weird, because the question then becomes, well, I know the Joseki is to continue here, right? So since my opponent didn't do that, surely the best move for me to play is Black's move, right? Get rid of the base. But in this case, it really isn't, because these two stones, it turns out, can settle very, very easily. This is not the actual game. But we can see, for example, that no matter how we try to play, even if we want to play as severe as humanly possible against these stones, we know they're pretty resilient. We know they're resilient enough to make shape, and they're even resilient enough to be able to still like make shape and escape, right? It can make this kind of thing. And can even turn here and get a larger base. So it's really, really difficult to actually take advantage of these moves. Get rid of these off the board. Thank you very much. So it's not a very large move to go back and pincer these, since we know that it can attach and do pretty well. The question is, what do we give up then if we decide to do that and it escapes? Well, right now it might give up the ability to save this stone if we're not careful. So the fact that we can put a little bit of pressure on here but it's going to settle, is it worth potentially getting rid of our ability to aid this stone? Probably not. Probably not. So White backs off. Black says, ha 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 ha, I tricked you. Now you have to turn, and when you turn, you will be attacked, for you cannot extend as you want to extend. But that's pretty simple. This is like 5Q stuff. This is the kind of thing you see when you're 5. If you're at least 5Q, you've seen this before. Where your opponent's played like ahead of your stone, expecting you to turn and then attack, right? But do we really need to? I mean, really? Is this that important that we're going to turn right now? Definitely not. And how do we know? Well, look at all of these low lines. Third line, second line. How much is he making from that? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, let's say 20. So he might have 20 points if we let him get that. And if we do let him get that, we are getting a lot of influence. So who cares? No one cares. No one cares about that at all. Black can play that way all day. It's not going to win him any games. So once we understand that we don't care what happens here, once we know that we couldn't care less about our opponent running this way, then we know we can play elsewhere, right? Makes sense. Who cares? Haha, Sente. Ghost Squall, welcome to the stream. So yes, obviously White's going to play elsewhere, and in this case he's going to approach because he has a potential wall in his hands, right? The whole, you know, that variation. And maybe even getting more of a wall over here by leaning on the 3-4 stone. So it makes perfect sense. That is why we're approaching from this way and not that way. That, and as we can see, you could go fundamentally. You could go back to the fundamentals as to why we're doing that as well, right? We could say, well, which side is larger? I was told to approach from that side, and I see that this is the larger side, so I'm going to play there. But the problem is, you could listen to that old sage advice, but you might not know why you're doing it. So this is another example of why you're doing it. We can see that our stones are working together if we do. Black can also see that, and he says, no, you are not doing that, sir. Because he's interested in here as well. If he gets some kind of attack going here, for example, that's pretty good for him. Can develop the side. As almost every time we see it, and I want to say 90%, 95%, somewhere in there, every time we see the pincer on the low approach onto the 4-4 stone, no surprise that we don't see a jump out. Why isn't it a surprise? Because there's nothing there for us. If we jump out, the only thing that we can do is lean. And now we're saying this right here, this is how we're getting our territory. This is gonna live, that's gonna live, but we're gonna develop here, and that's our win condition. That's bad. There's so many ways to reduce this, you would not wanna play this. You wouldn't look at here, for example, say, ooh, 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 fourth line, ooh, ooh, fourth line, ooh, 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 ooh. Fourth line, I can develop this. No, you can't. No, you can't. The middle is so hard to hold. Giving up the sides, development like on three different parts of the board to say, I'm gonna go all in on the middle, that's gonna probably net you a loss. Almost every time. Unless you're playing a teaching game, then you might get away with it. Not that I've done that before. Don't play twice in a row. There we go. So White changed directions. Obviously. Obvious to everyone now. Black says, alright, that's still not to be going anywhere. Aji, aji, aji. And, of course, Jisaki. Gonna go ahead and cut. Force an exchange here. Killing off my stones. Exchange for the corner. And now, there's an option here with this Jiseki. It's usually regarded as okay to continue this and extend. Some players will look at that and be like, no, that's way too small. And a lot of players as white would look at here and go, that was way too small too. I totally agree. But moves like this are really, really large if you do that, including moves like this, where there's no real way to kill the stone, because if we go here, we can extend and Hane under and probably kill off the two stone. And if we play here, then we're completely enclosing the corner because we're going to extend, connect, turn. Then we have the outside. So this is usually also going to be Sente. But you are choosing to make that exchange then and say, you know what, just take the rest of the top while I defend myself there. Just take the rest of the top. I don't care. And sometimes that's an okay thing to say, because maybe these stones weren't there, and this is a nice strong black group where there's nothing to extend to. Then there's no reason, none whatsoever, not to go ahead and play here, because there's nothing on the nothing over there for white anyway. Here, no reason to quite make that exchange, because it looks like that will actually turn into solid territory, given the other stones on the board, right? So, okay, no reason to make that exchange right now. So, what are we going to do instead? Well, we've got a weak group on the board. We've got a stone we absolutely do not want to play, and that's this one. Don't want to play this. Just makes our opponent way too strong. The upper li that this side of this group here, we're going to pretend that this one's never played. We're going to, but we're both going to agree to ignore that side of the board, because it's ugly. I mean, this is working perfectly. This has got nice shape. This is doing pretty well. And then there's that. Yeah. It looks like the only thing that group is doing is it just wants attention. So we're not going to give it attention. Instead, we're going to look at the weak group on the board, and we're going to attack it. But the question is how? Where's our profit coming from, right? That's what we want to know when we attack things. Like this group, if I were to attack, we're not attacking this way. No. And we can't attack here because there's no profit here for us either. All the profit is here, so all right, we're gonna go that way. So far, it makes sense. And so far, with the slight exception of this Jiseki and arguably this Jiseki, not much is going too unusual, because usually we don't have this exchange by white nowadays. White usually just goes directly into the corner, but this is still okay. This is still okay. It's not as weird as this one. But all right, now that we have that, how do these stones deal with themselves? Because this is a situation that probably comes up a lot. You've got two stones. What do? You see what your opponent's trying to do as well. And I know some aggressive players out there, maybe even watching right now. I know what you're gonna do. You're gonna be like, oh, I'm going deeper into the territories. And that's not really a good idea. Because one, you're making your opponent stronger, or you're letting him just flat out cut you. So that's bad right there. So then you could decide, well, I'm going to play this way then. Okay, but then we're going back to the making your opponent stronger bit. You're giving away free moves. And if you're not careful, you lose Sente once, and you're probably just going to fall over dead. So going deeper, being greedy, and trying to like get rid of that, not a good idea. So White says, "I'm out of here." All right, we're hurting our stone, or a black stone. So Black's going to respond clearly. And Black's going to say, "I'm going to strengthen myself." And White says, "Thank you very much. I'm going to get out of here as fast as humanly possible." That makes sense. That makes sense. Need to make use of that stone. Otherwise, why did we play it? If we play over here, for example, then this is still not giving very much use. We could play here, kind of passive. And remember, black is Sedol. He does not want to be passive, he wants to be aggressive. So he decides to attack most severely. White says, have at it. I'm going to connect up because we can see that there's actually potential here for Qingyao, isn't there? Yes, there is. So, all right, this makes sense. I like this. We could Hane in response, but that's playing into White's plans perfectly. And we might as well be asking White at this point where he would like us to play. And that's not the kind of player Sedol is. He's not going to try and do what his opponent wants him to do. No. So how do we get stronger here without making these three stones stronger? Because they're the only weak group on the board right now. We don't want to miss this our attack overrun here. So how do we do that? How do we make this group stronger without making that group stronger? Obviously, with what we saw earlier. We already knew the answer. We're going to lean on the really, really strong white group. Because if we get that really, really cool shape, then this group is isolated and will never connect. Aggressively responds, happy to continue responding, profits, comes on out, very painful play by black, getting a little bit desperate to try to remain outside. But he's leaving weaknesses behind. Not going to kill off our two stones, because that's insane. That just makes him live immediately, so we're just going to sacrifice here. Alright. Sacrifice accomplished. Not a co, so we connect. Black Atari is way to freedom. And now he's out. Use that rather loosely. He is out. On the other hand, doesn't have the best of shapes, does he? Not quite the best. A lot of problems with this shape. There's throw in. There's numerous. Okay, I just fixed that and I just hit it again. There's numerous Atari. So what do we do? A lot of players would be like, you know what? All I can do right now is just extend and defend my shape. Or those of you who are uncomfortable about maybe life and death, you might think, ooh, I just need to fix this. Need to fix that base right now. Totally need to fix that base right now. But Sedol is aggressive. So let's see if you can come up with an aggressive answer. I am very curious. Can you see what Sedol does? If so, then congratulations. You too may be a professional one don who will someday be top of the Go world. But we need an aggressive response. We can't be passive. In games like this, where you've decided to be aggressive, the minute you lose that aggression, ooh, things kind of go downhill. Things go so downhill. So all right, we want to be in the driver's seat, want to be aggressive, need to find an aggressive answer. So if you found the pincer, then congratulations. Got a little bit of influence. We can kind of envision a connection here. These stones are they're happily cut off. That's a very big swing into Black's favor. Unfortunately, shape is always so important. Always so important. And white counters. Like, all right. We're cut off. Clearly, we're cut off. But we can fight. We can fight. We can Hane. Our opponent's gonna cut us. But we're gonna connect. This is getting slightly uncomfortable. But it's fine, because we can push out. But that means white connects. Well, not quite. I mean, there's stuff there still, but for the most part, he's kind of connecting. Now we have a choice to make. Big choice to make. What do we do now? A Gote move, and our opponent is going to aggressively follow up. So we're going to go after his base and make a base for ourselves, because we've got this stone that we can play now, right? We can drop down. We can see that maybe we get nice shape for ourselves. We can do that, and we can still jump out. So both these are still pretty good. White jumps. Black follows. A little bit of behind the enemy lines action going on here. White says no trickiness going on. Asks where his eyes are coming from. Responds, keeping him surrounded. Forcing black to make eyes. Eyes made, we retreat and strengthen ourselves. Now it looks like the attack is firmly against black. Just not where he wants it to be. It looks small because in a couple of moves, the board has radically stated that the person who is in the driver's seat is no longer black. White is firmly in the driver's seat right now. And you should take a moment to figure out why that is. Looking at this board, you should be able to see what's going on, where all of the Aji is located, because that's what all of these games are about. These games are about Aji, finding out where your opponent's pressure points are and just kind of poking at them. Get them to respond. See how they respond. Things like that. So black, baseless, must respond. I completely made my stones jump all over the place. Let's not do that again. That's bad. All right, start poking out some eyes. There we go with that. Made this into a forcing move, which is really nice for white. Because if that was Sente, this board would have been completely different. Completely different. Instead, white has Sente. And the result of that determines who the aggressor is. If black had Sente right now, then maybe he keeps applying pressure. Maybe he applies pressure, maybe he even just jumps, and that's pretty good too. But with white the aggressor, and white being fine in the corner, and on the side, he gets to go. in cap black. Huge swing in his favor. Enormous swing in his favor. Because now it's no longer white who's kind of being pressure on the board. Now everything is on black. One of the reasons is because of this shape here. In fact, if we were going around and looking at all of the Aji on the board, go back and move, we saw that there was still Aji with this group. There was still Aji with this group, which is why we capped it. And there's also Aji with these two stones as this group gets stronger. A little bit of a follow-up. We also have the stony here. So if we can see all of these stones on the board at once, we can see that a lot of black stones are running for their lives or not doing very much right now. This stone, this group, probably never doing very much. This one wasn't going to do much the minute it was created. These two stones have yet to be determined. So let's see how white takes advantage of all of this. He starts off with the cap. White says, White does not get to play twice. Ha ha, go figure that one. Black says, I'm going to get out of here. Can't do anything aggressive. White applies pressure. Black has no choice but to endure and come out, allowing white to link up and potentially take large area for himself. So right away, white is saying something very, very smart. He's not saying, I am attacking to kill you. He's saying, I'm attacking to profit. There's profit here in surrounding you. There's profit here in surrounding this group because it's not 100% alive yet. Even if it was Gotei, it's still pretty good. And we're going to get these moves in before, you know, trying all of these sorts of things, like keep applying pressure here and keep applying pressure here, especially this one. If we kept up this aggression on here right now, what if we ran this group into this area? It might surround our stones. That's bad. It might kill all of our potential. That would be worse. So there's no reason to keep poking at this group right now. And every reason not to. I hope that makes sense for everyone. Black says, I have to live. I have to live. White gets to extend, and oh my god, look at that shape. Do you see the shape that group is being forced to make? So painful. How many moves? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10? And it's gonna make two eyes? If it's lucky? Ugh. Ugh, no one likes that. No one likes that. But, sadly, Black's move now. He says, I'm not taking this lying down. I'm going to attack you. You're going to defend, and this board will swing back in my favor. Perfect, perfect answer. If you are on the defensive, you've got to find a way to change that. Because every move where your opponent gets to keep pressuring you, keeps dictating the flow of the game, that's another move you didn't make territory that you wanted to. It's another move you didn't get to attack like you wanted to. It's another group that's going to make all the shape it needs to, so you never can attack it. You definitely need that tempo switch as fast as you possibly can get it. So Black says, this is my tempo switch. We are going to focus on this, and I'm going to get back in this game. So, all right, made that heavier. Play the Hane, try to wreck this shape. But unfortunately, the counterattack is way too easy. because black stones have really, really bad shape. This small knight here is just completely red-faced right now. It's like, dude, I get it. You were just trying to get back into the game, but I'm dropping the ball completely. I mean, you gotta look after me or we're dead. Black says, forget that. We're still gonna poke. Fixing some shapes. Plays the Atari. And comes out. Now that's an interesting variation right there. Because you can see that by playing this way, black is allowed to cut, right? I mean, the stone's dead, that is completely playable. However, it doesn't matter anymore. Those stones are doing nothing and the new target is here. For the moment. If he wants four stones in exchange for this area, pretty good, pretty good. And this is black's big play, right? And white's just gonna try and profit from black's big play. Like, congratulations, you had a thing going here. Now you take those stones while I kill off this stuff. So we can't do that. Instead, black says, no, you are the one with the shape problem, sir. And white says, no, you really are the one who's got the shape problems. Can't push through because the cut is sensei and then you're just going to kill off everything. But we do get to connect, and that's something. Get to the connect. Forcing moves. No chance to do anything. Goes back and connects. Threatens going underneath. Playable. We've got the take, we've got the throw. It's all right. White gets to connect as a result. Black says, no, you should not have done that. My moves are worth responding to. Unfortunately, he needs to make certain that, no, you don't get to play twice. Wait, what? Yeah. Don't get to play twice. Black gets to turn, ensuring that this is toast. Unfortunately, by doing that, white gets to connect. Nice and solid response. And we are suddenly not having a very good time here as black. Because it would seem that whatever we thought we were trying to do here, it's not really gotten what we wanted out of it. We were hoping for responses, we were going to kill off this area. Black just played twice. Really? Oh, okay. Yeah, sorry. You're right. Black took. White responded, and then black went back and played here. Sorry. I confused myself and forgot to play a stone. But yes, after the take, white extends, and then goes back and plays there. In my head, the stone existed. But alright, so now black has to decide what to do. And his choices are not enviable in any way. Because he can see his territory. Knows is not very much. You can see his white's territory, like, okay, white's got some territory, a little bit, but, you know, not that much either. But it's threatening to grow. So we gotta do something about that. So aggressive. So aggressive. Horrifyingly aggressive. I mean, look at what he just did. He's jumping way, way too deep. Especially with all the agi that we mentioned was over here, right? Because what's white gonna do? White's gonna descend. Black's gonna say, those stones are mine. White's gonna Atari. And then leave no agi behind. All right. So that's we have our answer to. There's like almost no agi over there anymore. So Black says, "What about over here?" Like, what about over here? Are we good over here? Is this okay? Ghost Squall asks, white is alive in that corner being this one, and we are going to get our answer to that in a moment. I assure you. All right. So here we are with this. I love White's responses. He's nice and calm about it. You know, I'm just gonna take my profit. This is mine. I'm not gonna be greedy. I'm not gonna get into White's game. I'm not gonna get into White's game and try to kill it, or Black's game, sorry, and try to kill everything. Because White knows he's sitting pretty comfortable right now. And what Black is looking for is a huge fight that he can use to come back into the game. He needs Aji by the boatloads to get back into this game. And White's just like, no, this is mine. Go away. If you go away, we know immediately that this stuff is going to turn a little bit more territorial than it currently is. So sure, how about it? Take that. Take it. Away with it. I do not want it. Black knows he has to keep this area reduced. White, the level of White's concern is truly touching. He's like, oh, okay. I'm just gonna take some territory here then, because it's Sente, otherwise you're dead. Very nice, grabs an eye for himself and threatens Hane. Black has to live. And the moves that Black has to play in order to live are really, really painful. But he is in fact alive, so that's good. White says, I'm nice and strong. This is not Sente for you. I guess to go back and play in the corner. The question, of course, I'm thinking everyone was wondering, though, was what happened if this was played, right? And the trouble with this it is really, really hard to keep this corner killed, right? We just can't get all the moves that we need in order to kill it. So yeah, that corner was fine. That corner was okay. Because we didn't have a good answer to that throw-in. I mean, the only thing we could do after the throw-in and the descent is to go down again. But that's not going to really work out so well. I mean, what's the shape that we would be using to kill this? Too many, right? There's like no shape we can play that is going to be a dead shape for black, or for white, right? Alright, so yeah, corner was fine. Let's see, descended there. Black takes sente for the reduction. This move was large, though. This move is very, very large, because now, you know, white can do cool things over there. Black is playing with fire. White's responding, keeping his profit. Black's trying to remain aggressive, as aggressive as he possibly can. But white's strong, so he's dodging. It's like, you're gonna play a small knight right in front of me? Are you nuts? I'm gonna cut that stuff. White's like, that's, or black's like, that's fine, I'll live. I mean, Sedol. I live everywhere. So here we see Sedol living. But we can count the problem on the board right now, can't we? All we need is addition to see what the problem here on this board is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 6. Not sure what to count these two stones as right now. But yeah, there's 6 groups for black on the board right now. I'll let you in a secret. The goal of this game is not to make as many groups as you can. Usually, if your opponent is surrounding that many groups, he's so far ahead of you. Because that influence from surrounding you is usually worth a lot. It's one of the reasons why Go is called the surrounding game, because surrounding things is really beneficial. You have no idea what your next move should be. Probably should be to surround something. Or try to surround something. Threatens a corner, because why not? That's the largest source of black territory right now. Black says, no coming into my territory. White's using his influence that he can now completely connect to easy peasy. There's so many ways to connect to back. So no fear of getting cut off. No fear whatsoever. On the other hand, black, yeah, he's the one that's a little bit afraid of being cut off. A little bit too aggressive here for black, as you can see. But he knows the only way he's going to win this game is through fighting. He has too many groups. He's got to fight. But white, he's really strong. He's everywhere. And he's nice and solid in almost all of his positions. Threatens to surround. White's just like, all right, I'll just surround this group. Black takes, because he has to. White's like, fine, I'll just surround this group. Oops, sorry. Black comes out. White gets to surround this group. No need to worry about being separated, even if it was possible, because we've got so much Aji all over the place. Connect. 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 Surround and connect. Now that he's surrounded, needs to live. There goes an eye. That's troubling. We need another one. White's saying if you're alive, you need to prove it. Nice and strong shape. Nice forcing moves. Picking up all the free points on the board. Be a blackstone. There we go. Separating, even with the Atari. Which is connected. Forced to go back and play an Atari, which allows for the cut. Ah, shoot, I hate long groups like this. One stone's out of place, man, they're all out of place. There we go. Black gets his shape. White connects. Black is forced to connect. And white is fine to just go into endgame. He's okay with that. Why wouldn't he be? He's got quite a few points. But black. Black is Sedol. He doesn't just calmly walk to his death. So he says, no, I'm gonna go over here. I'm playing in that corner. White Hane. Black connects, thinking we got Sentai here. Threatens to take out another eye. It's only got two, so he has to respond. Black says, all right. Or white says, okay, if you're not going to defend those stones, I will. Black says, that's cool, because I'm going to cut you. But as we saw earlier, and the variation, it's really, really hard to actually kill this shape. So once that answer is found, we realize we can't do anything else. That's Ko at best. So all we can do is resign. So what we saw in this game is Black was aggressive right from the very beginning of the game. A 1 Don professional against an 8 Don professional. And he went after him as aggressively as he could right from the beginning. And as you can tell by him having to live everywhere, he attacked pretty much everything, tried to reduce pretty much everything in this insanely aggressive style. But unfortunately, his shape was lacking. He had a serious shape problem. Every time he tried to get into fights in the middle, he found shape was not up to standard. His shape, again, just not doing it over here. So, very aggressive, but seems like this game he needed to work on his shape. He needed to have that aggression, but still have his groups not be in as mortal danger as they were. So that's interesting. A glimpse of early Yeast Sedol. I like the game, simply because it kind of helped. Yeah, it kind of helps show how to deal with really, really aggressive players. I mean, Chang'e didn't really do much that was very difficult. He's like, well, what am I going to do? I'm going to get good shape, and I'm just going to, you know, surround all the groups this guy seems to want to make. I think it'll work out well for me. And it does. It really does. When someone's busy, you know, not tending to their own groups and always playing around the board, then this happens. Even if you live everywhere, as we see here, living everywhere, it's not enough. And I bet you probably never thought that you would get that lesson from Yeast Sedol, having played that style. But yeah, as a one-dan professional, I guess he found himself a little bit overwhelmed by the 8th dan, and found himself trying to do just that. It's all right. I thought this game was very interesting for that reason. I mean, I would never would have expected a game like this from Yeast Sedol. Never, never, never. But sure enough he did. Back in the day. Back in 1997 when he was like 14 years old or something. That is what he did. But all right, hope you liked this game. And learned a little bit about it. A little bit from it, rather.